Dear Diary, I walk toward my spacious new office today for my first day as manager of Scuderia Quantistica. I felt a small amount of concern as I walked past the former cattle barn that we were using as a factory. The concern heightened as one of my mechanics looked quizzically at a screwdriver and asked me, "Hey boss, do you know what this does?" I strolled through the renovated portaloo that we were using as a design center and saw my chief designer with a Meccano set on her desk, with the instructions upside down. I turned to Max, who said to me, "So yeah, let's do that." Welcome back, or welcome for the first time, to TM1 Bytes Weekend Edition, where we are returning to our tutorial series on the game Motorsport Manager. This is part 3. In part 1, we looked at a general overview of the game, and I do recommend that you watch that. In part 2, we created our own team, which is Scuderia Quantistica, or actually, my own team. We are now at the team portal, and as with many portals on many websites throughout the world, it is initially more confusing than enlightening. I don't spend a lot of time here, but it can give you a high-level overview, and more importantly, it can help you to navigate to the most important places. There are, in fact, multiple ways to navigate. This is the sort of portal where you can have multiple paths to get to the one place. So up here, for example, we have our cash balance. If we click on the drop-down, you will see, well, actually, if you click on the drop-down, you would have seen very, very briefly the cash balance over the previous 3 months, which is this graph down here. But since we clicked on it, we actually went into the finances page. Now, the available budget, as I mentioned in the previous video, this is not a budget. This is just your current cash balance. You will get additional cash later on. Your cost per race will also actually increase. This is supposedly an indication of what your costs are going to be for each race. In reality, it isn't, because it includes the chairman payment, which is actually just a one-off cash amount. It has the travel costs, which are broken down into, if you can click on this little magnifying glass there, it'll show you what the details of those are. So that's tyre supply, tyre type, travel costs and fuel costs. I told you that €30,000 was a little bit optimistic. You've got the headquarters upkeep and staff. Now, that's composed of the factory and design centre upkeep, which are the only two buildings that we have at the start. One of the first things that I'm going to be doing is upgrading the factory, so that's going to increase over the course of the year. We have the designer, who's on a rolling contract and is being paid €1,000 per race. That's going to change because we need a decent designer. Same with the two race mechanics, so we have two mechanics, each of which is on a rolling contract, getting €1,000 per race. They are pretty much worthless, so we're going to get rid of them. Up here we have the drivers. That's a different story, and we'll come back to that shortly. And $700,000 is the amount that we set aside each race for next year's car. When we buy some headquarters buildings, that's going to go into headquarters building purchases, which it shouldn't really do because that's not really a profit and loss issue. It's a capital cost, but this is more or less a cash flow statement rather than an actual profit and loss statement. We will be getting additional revenue from the sponsors. We will be getting some reduction in costs, which will be shown as a revenue item under financial manager skills. The point that I want to make, though, is not so much about the finances page. It's one of many pages that you need to become familiar with, but rather with the fact that if you look at these buttons down here, these are other ways to get into various parts of the portal. So if I just go over to scouting for a moment and then come back to finances, and see that I'm coming back to the same page that I could have come to. There's that drop down. Okay, that's actually of limited use. Like I said, it shows you your balance, your cash balance over the last 3 months, but that's largely irrelevant. You come back to the same page as I got to through clicking that. And standings, okay, so, and then I could actually go to standings through here. So, multiple ways to navigate to the one place. I think you'll find that, generally speaking, the buttons along the bottom are going to be the best way to navigate, except for a couple of things, which are, actually, it's only really one. The GMA, so these are the votes. Now, these are different to the votes that you might have seen in a previous episode, because I actually recreated a new game, because the one that you saw in that episode was created before the latest download pack, so I wanted to make sure that I was up to date. So we have a different set of votes here, which we'll go through when the time comes, but that is the only way that you can get to the votes. You actually go to the voting through your inbox, so this is just alerting you to what votes are coming up. One thing that you should really keep an eye on is this bell icon up here. So that is currently showing you that there are 5 alerts. Now this will come up if there are new sponsor offers or if there is new mail. So when we click on the drop down there, we'll see that there are 5 unread messages in my inbox. If we had sponsorship offers, that would come up as however many unread emails there are in my inbox, plus a number for however many sponsorship offers I have, plus whatever other information that I might be getting from other parts. It's generally going to be one of those two. It's either going to be email, which you get to through there, or it's going to be a sponsorship offer that you can get to through there. But of course, you can actually click on that and it will take you straight to the email as well. And now I think it is in fact time to go to our inbox. So if I go to unread messages, I can also click on the inbox icon down there. Thomas Winthrop, the start of something great. Kirkus, old chap, you didn't just think that you'd be handed the reins without any oversight, did you? Yeah, well, I was kind of hoping, Thomas. He's a British guy, by the way, that's why I'm doing that accent. Your investors have asked me to keep an eye on how things are progressing. I'll be acting as your chairman, and I have the powers to remove you from your jobs if things aren't, shall we say, going to plan. Anyway, I look forward to working with you.
Yeah, I wish I could say the same.
Rest assured that there is plenty to do.
Yes, I have noticed that. Okay, another email from my new assistant, Diego Arati.
Hi Kirkus, first of all, can I just say that I'm amazingly excited to be your assistant here at this wonderful new venture.
So you should be, Diego.
Just saying that I work for Scuderia Quantistica gives me immense pleasure, I can assure you.
Yeah, you and me both, buddy.
I'll be around to update you with everything from around the team. For now, it might be an idea to start signing some sponsorship deals. We don't have any sponsorship offers yet, Diego, pay attention. And looking around for some driving talent.
Well, yeah, but there is a problem there, and I'll tell you about that in a moment, Diego.
Anyway, thanks for the opportunity. Let's make Scuderia Quantistica the best team in the world.
Oh, yes, that is what we are going to do. Now, I'm going to skip over this one and this one for a moment and just bring you up to Introduction to Weight Stripping. This is something new that came out with the Devils in the Detail pack. So he's saying it's important that you know about a GMA-wide change. GMA is the Global Motorsport Association. It's the fictional body that oversees all of these races. Change to car modifications on race weekends. By the way, Ernie Heckelrock is the president of the Global Motorsports Association. You might notice a certain similarity to the name of a certain motorsports administrator who shall remain unnamed in this video. Weight stripping allows teams to strip car parts down to the bare bones in order to decrease the overall weight of the car. Stripping a car's parts hurts reliability but increases performance. Any reliability lost due to weight stripping is repaired after the race. Teams can perform weight stripping before practice, which we have in the ERS, qualifying, which we don't have, thank the gods, because I hate qualifying sessions, and race, which of course we have. However, any reliability lost in a previous session cannot be repaired until the race weekend is over. Okay, so when you're driving in a race, you will see the reliability gradually ease down. And when the reliability falls enough, that's when you start having problems with your parts and start having problems with your performance. If it gets bad enough, you can be out of the race. Reliability is shown as a percentage, as I've shown in previous films. And what this is essentially saying is that you can sacrifice some of your reliability percentage to save a bit of weight. Now, this probably makes weight more important than it has been in previous versions of the game. So in previous versions, the only way that you could really control weight, well, there were two ways, really. First, you could hire skinny drivers, and really, Weight was the last thing that I looked at, but it probably is an issue. And the second way is not to refuel all the way up, and thus reduce the fuel load that you're carrying. Now, this is making weight a far more important issue, because you can bet that the AI teams are going to be using this and using it well, or at least some of them will be. The introduction of weight stripping allows safer, more reliable teams to use their excess reliability to improve race performance. We at the GMA feel that this is sure to keep races near the end of the championship exciting. One of the issues that there was with the previous games before the Devils and the Detail Pack came out, a lot of people were complaining that at the start of the season you would have cars blowing up, but by the end of the season everybody was so reliable that it just wasn't happening, and I suspect that this aspect of gameplay was introduced to address that. So now you have this trade-off. If you just go for 100% reliability and you keep it at 100% reliability, then you are probably at a disadvantage to the teams that are trading off some of that for weight. So I suspect that there is a big performance issue in relation to the weight. I just haven't figured out how big that is. So I'm just going to say got it for that. It's got a must respond on it, but really it's just clicking on the button to say, got it, yes, I understand, I've heard what you are saying, Ernie Heckelrock. Targets for the first season. So good friend Thomas, our chairman, has. Targets, the first order of business has laid out our targets for the year. Actually, he doesn't look like the sort of guy who would talk like this, but still, that's what I'm going to do, because I can't really do an East End London accent very well, and I think that's probably what he would be using. The corresponding budget that you have set will have to last through all year, so be careful with your spending. Remember how I said that with a custom team you get the money up front. We need to build the team up completely from scratch. Frankly, we have temporary staff and drivers. Actually, we do not have temporary drivers. We have drivers on a 12-month contract. No sponsors. Oh, you haven't seen that yet, but trust me, it's there, and I shall show you in a moment. No sponsors, quite so. A weak car. We don't have a weak car, we have a pathetic car. And a shoddy HQ. We have a pathetic HQ. Not much to do, then. With this in mind, where do you think we can hope to finish by the end of the season? Okay, now, if I was actually playing this before the Devils in the Detail, I might have been half tempted to go for 8th. But the reality is, I haven't gotten my head around weight stripping yet. And also, it's going to be well into the season before we have our reliability up far enough to be able to use weight stripping. So, previously, I would have said, maybe we can come 8th, but I don't want to bet my career on it. Now, I am damn certain that we are not going to come 8th, and I am not going to bet my career on it. So I am going to say 10th, even though that'll only get me 13.84 million instead of 16.6. That's the trade-off that you have to consider. Newbie players will go in there and go, ooh, wow, I'd get an extra 3 million euros. Yeah, you will, but it means that the pressure on you to perform is going to be greater. Basically, we can come last in every race in this season, come dead last in the competition, which we will, and Thomas is going to be fine with that, because I've said we're going to come dead last in the competition. If I say we're going to come 8th, he's going to get unhappier and unhappier and unhappier, and I will probably end up being sacked from my own team at the end of the season. So that is not going to happen. We will choose 10th. And there you get this little window which tells you what's coming in and how your balance is going to change. So our current balance is the initial cash injection of 10 million. We will get 13.837 million. I will confirm that. And our balance is now 23.837 million, which is a heck of a lot less than it sounds. Because to start off with, I need to upgrade a couple of headquarters buildings, one of which is going to cost 8 million. Secondly, out of this balance, we're going to have to set aside 7 million for next year's car, at least. So that's 15 million out of that. You can see that it goes down pretty quick. So while I'd love to have that money, it's really not as much as you think it is, which is basically the same situation with your own salary when you look at it, especially if you have a mortgage. Silvia Confortola is my chief scout, and she says to me, "Hi Kirkus, I'd like to present my initial report of the state of the team. Take a deep breath." I don't need to, I already know what it's going to say. "Our drivers are awful." Actually, they're not completely awful, but they're not great. "Our designer is awful." Oh yeah. "Our mechanics are awful." Oh, I know. "You need to get hiring fast." You know where to find me. Where do I find her? Head to the scouting department, which is also available down there. And that is indeed something that we are going to do before we hit this continue button, which will cause the time to start moving along. We are currently still on the 1st of March 2016, but we have a lot to do before we hit that continue button and move on. Now, as much as I respect the opinion of my chief scout, we are not in fact going to go directly to the scouting department just yet, because first, we need a plan. Now, there's something I'm going to get out of the way up front. During the course of this episode, you are going to see TM1 cubes, you are going to see Excel sheets, you are going to see heat maps, you are going to see all sorts of things relating to data analysis, and you are going to probably go, this is completely over the top. Nobody would be doing this just to play a game, and you are right. But my point is that this, despite appearances, is not my bread and butter series. As of the time of release, this may be different when you're watching this, however far off into the future that may be, if anybody does actually watch this, then I may have my main series out. But my bread and butter series is about data management, it's about data analysis, it's about analysis software such as TM1, such as Excel, such as Microsoft Office, and I'm obviously not going to pass up the opportunity to use some not real life, but certainly practical data for analysis purposes, which will then recycle its way back into episodes relating to Excel and to TM1 and so on and so forth. Am I expecting you to do the same thing? No, obviously not. But I am going to be pointing you in the direction to look at the things you need to look at. How you decide to do that, that's entirely up to you. So I'm going to be drilling right down into the numbers, but that is just to give you some guidance into how the numbers work. You don't need to be doing the same level of analysis as I do, and I'm not expecting you to, and I'm not even suggesting that you do. The whole reason is basically as a supplement to my main series. So, with that said, the place that I want to visit is the calendar. There's no actual point going out onto a racetrack if you are not set up to win on that racetrack. And in that respect, if we take a look at the drop-down for the calendar there, you can see that there is a summary and we can go through that. But if we click directly into that, or down through the calendar icon here, we will get more details on each track. Now, one of the most important things, and the only thing that I'm concerned about right at this moment, is this over here on the track guide, which tells you what the most important components are. So in this case, in the case of the first race that's coming up in the Black Sea, it's going to be top speed, which is the engine, acceleration, which is the gearbox, high speed corners, which is the rear wing. We can't do anything about that because that's a spec part. We go down to Munich, we have acceleration, low speed corners, medium speed corners. You see the track layout there. Generally speaking, if you have long straights, then top speed is going to be critical. If you have a lot of curvature, then acceleration and deceleration and probably cornering will be critical. So you see that the Munich layout there does not have a lot in the way of straights. There's a stretch down there where you're probably going to get up to top speed, and then you're immediately going to have to come to a halt and swing around almost 180 degrees, or in fact over 180 degrees. One other thing to note too is that different track layouts for the same track may in fact have different requirements. So we can see here in our first race in Munich on the 14th of April, we're using track layout B, and these are our three most important characteristics: acceleration, low speed corners, and medium speed corners. But when we look at the August race, which is on track layout A, acceleration, deceleration instead of low speed corners, and medium speed corners. If the tracks are very similar, so Milano in our first race, top speed, deceleration, high speed corners. Milano in the second race, top speed, deceleration, high speed corners. The track layouts in Milano are A and B and are almost identical to each other. So the only difference is that little kink there. This did actually make a difference before the last update package came out. I remember that the two Milano races required different parts, but now after the update package I've noticed that they're exactly the same. And the reason that it required something different before, I think, was you no longer had a long straight down there. You had that curve in it, which obviously you can't push it up to top speed down there if you're suddenly going to have to swing into a corner and then head down there. But top speed is still reasonably critical because you've still got a relatively long straight down there. You've certainly got a longish straight up there. So that would be why that is important. So here's the thing. We need to work out what the most important parts are and target our part development in that direction. And also, that's going to affect the designer that we hire, because we're going to want somebody who can design the parts that we actually need to be successful in our races. Welcome to TM1. Over here, I've created a cube which has information about the tracks. You don't need to know what a cube is. If you're not a TM1 user, you probably don't. And it's not important. Once you open it up, you'll see exactly what it is. And TM1 is really easy to use once you get used to it. So if we look at parts by race, which is a view of that cube, we will see that I have allocated 2 points for every part that is crucial. Okay? Not every part is crucial all the time. When we go down to Tondela, the first race in Tondela, for example, we have acceleration, which is crucial, low speed corners, which is crucial, but top speed is only useful. So for anything that is merely useful, I have allocated only 1 point. For anything that is critical, I have allocated 2 points. So what do we see as the final outcome of that? We see that acceleration has 13 points. Top speed has 14 points. So engines are critical. The next most critical thing is the gearbox. Third is high speed corners, but that's the rear wing, which we can't do anything about because it's a spec part. Next up is low speed corners, front wing, can't do anything about that, that's fine. Next up is brakes, but that's half, less than half the value of the gearbox or the engine. And then bringing up the rear is medium speed corners, which is the suspension. Okay, so we need a strategy. If I had gone for Golden Tiger as my backer, as you saw in the previous episode, and I had a test track, and I had an extra 5 million in my starting balance, maybe I could have gone for top speed. But there were other issues with that, such as the fact that the pressure would have been high, so the expectation to achieve results would have been high, and even with that extra 5 million and the test track, I don't think we could meet those expectations. So we need to do something about our engine. Why? Because I'm just jumping ahead a little bit here, but if we look at our engine, it has a maximum of 7 for that one and a maximum of 12 for that one. That's not even remotely competitive. So we are going to need to do an engine. Actually, we're going to need to do 2 engines because you're going to need one for each car. But we can't get so many engines developed over the course of the year because they cost $1.5 million per. So my strategy is not to go for top speed. My strategy is just to get us engines which are at least competitive, which our existing engines are not. And we are going to be the acceleration guys. Acceleration through the gearbox, deceleration through the brakes. That's where we're going to concentrate our effort, because a lot of the tracks are going to have curves. Acceleration is critical in almost as many races as top speed. So if we can outperform the competition in acceleration and deceleration and just keep competitive in top speed, maybe we can do something. Actually, I'm hoping it's more than a maybe, otherwise there's just no point. So the next question is, how much money do we have to develop parts? So the next thing I did was to sit down and work out a cash flow budget, which again, some people are going to go, oh, wow, you're kidding me. You didn't really do that. Yeah, I really did. And like I said, the reason is that this is not my bread and butter series, but this is going to be really useful for doing demonstrations in what is my bread and butter series. So I have worked out an estimate of how much we are going to be spending over the course of the year, week by week, or race by race, which is what the majority of it is calculated as. Some of it will be by week, such as building headquarters buildings. And I have worked out that we're going to have, before part development, a net cash flow of $6.2 million. This is a little bit pessimistic because it was based on the cost of the chief designer that I was previously using, and she was a mistake, as we shall see, and the new designer is going to cost us a little bit less, and also I've been relatively pessimistic about our sponsorship money towards the end of the season. In fact, I can't even be 100% certain about our sponsorship money at the moment because there is a certain randomness to what offers you will get. So I've made my best guess based on what I've seen in previous games. So I've worked out 6.2 for the parts, if we spend every euro that we actually get in. So what does that get us? If you look on the master data sheet, 6.2 million, Our first engine is going to cost us $1.55 million. Our second engine is going to cost us $1.65 million. So we need two new engines before we hit the second season to be even remotely competitive. Gearboxes are going to be our forte, so obviously we're going to develop a minimum of two gearboxes, which is probably all we're going to have money to do this year. We're going to build at least one set of brakes, simply because brakes are relatively cheap, and we're also going to be deceleration guys. I would like to build a second set of brakes, but it depends on how much sponsorship money we have. So at the moment, we're going to end up with $259,000 remaining, which is not going to be enough to build even brakes, which are the cheapest components around. A second set of brakes would cost us $650,000, because it'd be $500,000 for the base, $50,000 for the average component, plus $100,000 for a good component, so $650,000 in total, and that leaves nothing left over for a new suspension unit. That we're just going to have to worry about in the new year, unless we get a heck of a lot more sponsorship money than I was actually expecting. Okay, now that we have a plan, now it is time to go to the scouting area and see if we can find ourselves a designer to implement that plan. So I'm going to go back to here, and I already have this email open, so I'm just going to click on there. As I said, I could also click on the button down there. This is the panel that gives you information about drivers, designers, and race mechanics. So you can select those three. For drivers, you can select between those in the single-seater series or those in the GT series. Assuming that you have the GT package, I'm not sure if that appears if you don't. Designers are just one group of designers, regardless of which competition they're running in. You can filter the list by age, so 16 to 22, you won't find any 16 to 22 year old designers. 22 to 28, it's not that relevant, it's mostly relevant for drivers, because 34 plus, most of the designers are at least pretty close to 34. You've got a couple of youngsters, relative youngsters in there, so 27, 28. But the other thing too is that, as I mentioned in previous videos, there is a peak age. The peak age for drivers is about 30, but the peak age for designers is an average of about 57. Now, you won't find this in the game. I found this out by hacking the database, which is something that we shall come back to in a moment. If you take a look at any individual designer, if you hover over them, you'll see their stats there. You can click on them to get a better, more detailed view. So it will show all of their stats up there. Now, there's something I need to talk about here too. In a previous video, I think it was episode 1, I mentioned that Paddy Locke had scores of 20. And so I figured there were actually 21 different values that you could have for any given stat, because you go from 0 to 20, that's actually 21 values counting the 0. However, after the devil's in the detail package, as you can see, Paddy's back to 19, and that makes a lot more sense, because if you have 20 different values from 0 to 19, multiplied by 6 different stats, that gives you a total of 120 possible scores. 120 divides by 5 to give you a star value much more easily than 126 does. So effectively, there's 24 different levels within each star, so a 1-star designer, if you don't know what the fraction of the star is, could be anywhere from 0 to 24. A 2-star designer could be anywhere from 25 up to 48, and so on and so forth. You do actually get to see partial stars on there, but it's a little bit rough, so you can only make an estimate of how far that star is filled in. There are two other reasons why stars are not exceptionally useful. The first one is that it depends on whether the stats are actually useful to you. So if you have somebody who has got front wing of 19 and rear wing of 19, that's not so useful in the ERS, because of course you can't develop those parts. If they're weak in all of the other areas, then you've got a designer who's really well skilled up in something that you can't use. The other thing is in respect of known components. Now, unfortunately, this is not reflected in the star rating at all. So you see Paddy, as you would expect, with this guy being the top designer in the entire set of competitions, he has special components at every single level. So in addition to the standard components that any designer can add to a gearbox or to brakes or to suspension, he knows extra ones. So let's go back to the list. And you can sort that list by score, so ability, and generally speaking, the more stars, the higher the cost per race. But unfortunately, this does not really give you a good indication of what somebody's real cost per race is going to be. It will give you some idea of how much that designer is going to cost you based on their number of stars. but it's only a general guide, because you can see here you've got somebody with 3 stars, which is Scott Moore, who's at $90,000, and you've got somebody at 3 and a little bit of a star, but with some expansion potential, Braylon Stockwell at $241,000. Okay, so if you've got a 3-star designer, these ones who are unemployed, how much are they actually worth? Because there's a big gap in between there. And that can be really difficult. And that is essentially how I fell into the Karina Ryder trap, because she is the one that I selected as our designer in a previous game. You can see that she actually has pretty decent stats across the entire range, and she has an adequate improvement rate of 1.15, and more importantly, she has some space to improve. So you can see that there is 0.5 star, which is empty there. But she was an incredibly bad choice. Let's go back to the list again. This is where it becomes really, really difficult, because if you are looking for a designer with a specific set of skills, you are so limited in how you can filter this list. The only filter that you have is the age. You can filter also by specific star count, but that doesn't help you work out whether the talents are the ones that you need. So, I'm afraid I did do something a little bit naughty. I hacked the database. Now, this is not really, really cheating, because all of the information that I took from the database, I ignored anything that was not available through the portal. I just took all of the bits that were available through here, except for one thing. I couldn't resist the temptation. I wanted to work out what the average age of peaking was. And as I said, that was just a little bit over 57. I did not look at the individual peak times for individual designers, because that information isn't available to you. It's hidden from you as part of the randomness of the game, and so I wasn't going to go down that path. But if we go over to the master data file again, and we move across to the designers list, this is the database that I have. I just did a quick off-screen correction to get rid of the decimal places in the wage and break columns, but other than that, this is the data that came out of the database, and I've added a few extra columns with calculated values in them. You can see that we have the scores for the individual components or individual parts within a car. They are decimal values, they are not rounded values, so it's not surprising that we have sometimes issues with roundings. What I might do is sort this by total score, just out of interest. So if we go Z to A and we look at the total score, obviously Paddy Locke is way up there on top with 114 points. Now the ERS total is the total of everything except the front and rear wings, because obviously we can't use that particular skill. So this is the value that is important to us. If I just turn on the heat map on the totals for a moment, you can see that there is something of a correlation. The green ones represent the highest scores, the yellow ones intermediate scores, down to reds, which are the lowest scores. And there is some degree of correlation, but there are also a few cases where there is no correlation whatsoever. So, for example, Paddy obviously is the top in both, he's just the legend. But if we take a look at, for example, Mitchell Abrahams, he is, in fact, 86 in total, but only 47.93. What that means is that he has awesome kung fu when it comes to the wings. So he's got 18.76 on the front wing, 19.31 on the rear wing, which is completely useless to us. So we would be paying for an 86 level designer, which he's getting paid at the moment €399,000 per race. The per race numbers, this is another reason why it's difficult to get a handle on how much a designer or even a mechanic is worth, because they get paid per race, but remember that there are a different number of races in each competition. So ERS has 10 and APS has 11. So if you're a designer in the APS and you're getting paid the same amount per race as a designer in the ERS, you're automatically getting 10% more than they are. So that's another thing to be aware of. But he's getting paid $399,000 regardless of how many races there are in the International GT Series, and I can't remember off the top of my head. This guy would be useless to us, because we're going to be paying through the nose for his services, and he's not going to be delivering what we need. He's only got 9.27 on the gearbox, for example. Conversely, we have Ms. Karina Ryder, who was my mistake. Okay, so she's got 3.04 stars with 13 potential. The problem is that she's got a score of 73. She's unemployed, so there's no indication of how much she would be getting paid at the moment. But when you look at the ERS score, the score that is relevant to us, she's only at 46.36. Now, if we sort this by total, actually, I think I still have it sorted by total, do I? We'll just resort it just to be on the safe side. Okay, if we take a look at the designers in the low 70s, most of them are getting paid 89,000, 98,000. So again, this is probably going to be the number of races factoring in. That's why you're getting such radically different numbers there. But we've got 100,000 here for somebody who's got 72, and then we go up to 241,000 for somebody who's at 79. So Karina sits on top of that pile. But the thing is that she would not accept a salary less than 175,000 euros, and I ended up paying it because you don't have a really good view. Without a table like this, you don't have a good view of how much a designer is worth. Now I know, and now I would never have paid that. Now, this is not to say that she is a bad designer. She actually has a good range of skills across the board. Not outstanding skills, not spectacular skills, but quite capable in every single part. Gearbox she's a little bit weak on, but she has 13 points of growth potential, so potentially she could up by 2 in every category. Although you do have to bear in mind that growth can take an awfully long time, because the growth rate is, it depends on the designer and how old they are, but it'll probably be somewhere between 0.85 and 1.15 for most of them, and that is expressed as a percentage, but I think it's actually percentage points, so it's addition rather than multiplication. So let's use this table to figure out who we want. I'm going to put a filter on it. The brake cost, we cannot afford to pay more than, say, 250,000, so it has to be less than 250,000. Okay, and that immediately cuts us down to only 27 out of the 66. The engine, we need somebody who is really capable on the engine. So I don't want anybody who has a value of less than 10. So we're going to filter it to everybody who is greater than 10. Now we're down to 10 out of 66. Let me just move across here a little bit so that we can see who these people are that we're talking about. What I might now do is sort by ERS total, because that's going to be the most important to us. And so what have we got on top? We've got Vasily Sokolov. So he's got 57.44. He has got engine of 17.71, which is rather nice. Gearbox of 8.76, which is rather less nice. Good on brakes. Lousy on front wing, but we don't care. Great on suspension. Pretty good on rear wing, which we don't care about. So he suffers a little bit from the Karina Ryder syndrome, where we would be collecting, 13.56 points worth of skills that we cannot use. He's unemployed at the moment, so I'm not sure how that would put him in terms of payment. We've got Freddie Cooper. He's getting on a little bit. He's 52. Well, actually, so is Vasily. So he's within 5 years of peaking, but he has no potential growth anyway. But he has pretty awesome numbers in both engine and gearbox and brakes. The problem is he's got nothing in the way of suspension. So that may be an issue. Luke Savage, 43, 3 stars, 15.2. No, I don't think so, because I don't want anybody who is less than 10 on an engine or a gearbox. So I'm going to filter that out, is greater than 10. So it's coming down to Katie Paulson has a really nice engine number. She has a pretty decent gearbox number. She has 8.19 on brakes, but her suspension is even worse than Freddie's is. She is 41, so she should be a long way from peaking, and her ERS total is less. Okay, but her total of 53, so she's got 53, he's got 63, that means she's going to be cheaper for us to hire. And then we have Anne from France. She has a better spread across all of the components, all of the parts, but we don't need front wing or rear wing. Now, one thing to consider, we are going to need front wing and rear wing when we eventually get ourselves promoted into APS, but that's going to be a ways off. The longest contract that you can do initially is 3 years, and my feeling is that we are probably hiring a designer now who we are going to have to let go in 3 years. I don't like that. I don't like the idea of regarding people as expendable, but for the sake of the team, I really don't see that we have any choice. Wayne Bellows, not necessarily a bad choice, bit better on suspension, but you know what? Given that our strategy is to emphasize gearbox and brakes and try to jump our engines up so that they're within competitive range, we're going to lose out on the suspension, but I think Freddie is the man for us. Let's see if we can find out exactly how much he's going to cost. So I'm going to clear all of the filters, and Freddie was about 63, if I recall correctly. We're just going to filter, or sort rather, by total. So if we look at designers who are around 63, so we've got somebody at 65 there, is it 85,000, 80,000, 90,000, 73. So I would say we're going to be looking in the ballpark of 80 to 85,000 for Freddy, which is a heck of a saving over Karina. So he's the man that we're going to go for. So let's head back to the scouting area and see if he's interested in talking to us. Where are you, Freddy? You were here a minute ago. Freddy, we are still on designers. Freddy, here we go, Freddy. Ah, nice beard, Freddy. 19, 18, 19. He doesn't have any growth, but like I said, we're looking at somebody who's probably going to be with us for 3 years. He knows good parts, he knows great parts, he knows epic parts, which is a build time of minus 4 days and a cost of 1 million euros. I am not going to sacrifice 1 million euros to reduce the build time by 4 days. This could be more interesting on softs, supers and ultras, which is what we do most of our racing on. So performance of plus 15, reliability of minus 10. Actually, okay, that's not so great. I told you that these designer components were quite often rubbish. Let's see what Freddy has to say. He's unemployed, so he's probably happy to talk to us. He's interested. Let's start negotiations. This is your negotiation panel. There are basically, it depends on the individuals and what sort of role they have, but you're going to have a similar thing. You're going to have the cost per race, which is going to be his salary, how long the contract is going to be, if there is a signing on fee, and if there is a race bonus. So, Freddie says wages are fairly important to me. This is where it can get really confusing, because the thing is, you can't just specify any cost. You are given a range of costs, okay? And you have to select one from there. How these are selected, I have no idea. But obviously, Freddie's not going to sign on at 40,000. He's probably going to be insulted, and you do have to be careful here, because designers and race drivers and so on have a certain amount of patience. And if you don't offer them something decent, eventually their patience wears out, and after that they just won't talk to you anymore. So I'm not going to waste Freddy's time. I've estimated that he's going to be getting in the order of 80 to 85,000 for somebody with his total skills. So I'm going to offer him, 89, because I would prefer to sign him on the first go. 81 I think he might reject, and he says that wages are fairly important to him, which means that it's going to be a consideration. This is a little bit more than somebody of his skill set would be entitled to expect based on the database that we just saw. I want to sign him on for 3 years, because we are not going to get out of ERS this year. We probably won't next year. It'll be a miracle if we do, but the third year is probably the year that will be ours. We will own that championship in the third year if all goes well. So we'll keep Freddy until the end of 2018. He'd prefer a long contract anyway, so he's going to be happy with that. He'd prefer a signing on fee. I'm not too parsimonious with signing on fees, because I'd rather get the people that I want, but I'm sure as hell not going to pay him 600,000. Let's go down a little bit more. He may not be happy with what I'm going to offer him. two, three, four. So that's four below. Whoa, okay. That's a pretty big range of signing on fees. I thought you got fewer than that. I'm prepared to offer him... Okay, I cheated there. I went and took a look at what I'd budgeted for the designer signing on fee in the cash flow budget. I'd actually only budgeted 60,000 euros, but he says I'd prefer a signing on fee, not that it's important to him. Bonus size isn't very important to me. If I need a sweetener, I'll add it, but I think he should be reasonably happy with that. If he's not, I'm probably going to have to resave this game and come back to it. No, seriously. This is where the problem is, because Freddy's only got one X against him. Some of them have two or three. If he's not happy with this, he's probably going to stop talking to us. But I think he will be at least adequately happy, or happy enough to talk to us again. So I'm going to go continue and send that off to him. Now, because this is a tutorial, what I'm going to do here is do a time warp and bring in what his response is from the future so that we can see the entire process. And then we shall move on to looking at the other staff. And welcome to the future. We are on the 9th of March, which is 8 days out from the Black Sea GP, and we have received a response from Freddy. Freddy is neutral about his cost per race, 89,000. That's a fair value, Freddy. Oh, well, it's okay, he's neutral. That's all that's important. Contract length is 34 months. He's delighted with that because he wanted a long contract. He's insulted by his signing on fee, which is 60,000. Ah, that's right, Freddy, we could have offered him up to 600,000. But there was no way that I was going to do that, but he's insulted by that. That's sad. Because I didn't want to insult Freddy. I think Freddy's a very good designer in everything except suspension, so he has a race bonus of nothing, so he's neutral on that. So essentially what got us over the line is that there's two neutrals and one delighted versus one insulted. So I could have upped the signing on fee. I wasn't going to up it to 600,000, that was for damn sure. But it doesn't matter, he's agreed to join us. So once you have somebody who's agreed to join you, you will be getting the mail in your inbox. Freddy Cooper, contract looks good to me. Shall we sign the deal? Damn straight we shall sign the deal. So we sign him on there. And he is replacing Liliana. I'm sorry, Liliana. You're a really nice person, but you really have no talents when it comes to engineering race cars. Continue to finance. Okay, so I have to pay him 60,000, which for some reason I still get a financial manager discount on, so I pay him 57,000, and that's his signing on bonus, so that's going to reduce our balance a little bit, but I don't care, because that means that Freddy has come to work for me. So we shall now return to the present. Now we're going to look at the mechanics. We're not going to look at it in the same level of detail. I'm not going to take you through the entire thought process of picking them out, but I'll take you through the most important parts. There are six skills that a mechanic has. Reliability and performance relate to their performance in the factory. So when they're heading up the performance team and the reliability team, this is an indicator of the effect that they will have on those teams, and consequently how fast they improve the reliability and how fast they improve the performance. If you designed your ideal mechanic, they would have high scores in all six categories. And indeed, you need them to have reasonably decent scores in at least five categories, unless they're a new mechanic who has a lot of potential upside and a lot of empty stars that they can develop into. The exception is reliability and performance, because obviously you can only have one mechanic heading up each team at each time. So if you actually have somebody who is weak in reliability but strong in performance, you can complement them with another mechanic who has the opposite set of skills. Concentration affects, well actually let's look at pit stops first. Okay, when you do a pit stop in a race, then this determines how well they do those pit stops. But the other factor in relation to that is concentration. So the higher their concentration score, the less likely they are to make a mistake in the pit stop. Mistakes obviously cost you time. Part fixes. At the end of a race, you get an email from the mechanic who has the highest part fixes score saying, well, that wasn't the ideal weekend. It's never the ideal weekend. It's always the same email. X's car has dropped by Y% and Zed's car has dropped by alpha percent, so it's going to take us so long to fix it. In short, the higher the part fix score, the faster they will do that, and then the faster the factory can return to doing improvements on the parts. Now, how this is modelled, I'm not entirely sure, because I would have thought that the mechanic for each driver would be working on that driver's car, but that doesn't seem to be how it plays out, because you just get that one email from the best mechanic and that one email at the end when they've finished doing the part fixes. So I don't know whether it's just an average number or what it is, but in any case, the higher you've got that, then the faster they'll get back to doing their development. Chemistry, as I have mentioned previously, is their chemistry with the driver. The higher that is, the more likely the driver is to be able to pick up extra skills. In this case, because it's 3 out of 20, 2 out of 20, 1 out of 20, 1 out of 20, 2 out of 20, 1 out of 20, really not much is going to happen. There's only half a star of skill, no empty stars. We basically have to get rid of her. Sorry, Aya. If we look at her colleagues, Santiago Igor, I can't pronounce his name, so I'm going to have to sack him. Concentration of 3, part fixes 2, pit stop 0, performance 0, reliability, a whopping 3, and chemistry of 3. So neither of these two have acceptable figures, and they have no growth potential. So I need 2 new mechanics. My strategy is going to be that I'm going to get a more senior mechanic. Even if they don't have any growth, they will be able to at least anchor the team and provide good skills across the board. Also, I'm going to recruit another mechanic who has a lot of potential. Okay, heading for the database. First, I'm going to sort by skill. Then I'm going to apply a heat map to the skills. So green is high, red is low. Up at the top, we have this beautiful, lush area of high skills. The first filter that I'm going to apply is that I don't want a transfer cost of over $175,000. All of a sudden, that lush greenery turns into a desert with the occasional oasis. My senior mechanic, I want both reliability and performance to be over 10 so that I can switch them around in the headquarters as I need to. I want the chemistry to be over 5. Yes, I would like the drivers to inherit skills from their mechanics, but more importantly, I don't want a civil war between the drivers and the mechanics, because I've had that in the past too. And at the end of that, my choice is Gary Watson. Now, if it looks like I'm somewhere between decisive and impulsive there, I'm neither. I spent a chunk of one of my morning commutes looking at this, weighing up the best options, and you can still argue it other ways. That's the beauty of this game. There's no one right answer. Here's why I made the call I did. Maurizio I like. We worked together at Octane Racing in a previous life, and he worked out well. He has 5 points of improvement per category, so he's got 30 points in total. At which point his pit stop skills still won't be any better than Gary's are now, and he'll cost us a €144,000 break fee. Sally Cooper's pit stop skills are even worse, with fewer improvement points to work with, and she will cost us $20,000 more, just in the break fee. None of them have part fix skills that are worth a toss, and won't have even years down the track when the ones with development potential are fully developed, so let's call that a dead issue. Both Sally and Maurizio will become factory gods when they're fully developed, but that won't be for years. Gary gives us better than average skills in the factory that we can use now, and that's important. Next, all the best mechanics are named Gary, but only when they have 2 R's in their name. Gary's biggest positives are the fact that I can get better than average performance out of him on either factory team, as well as in pit stops, and I don't have to pay a break fee for him. His biggest negatives are in concentration, which means that when he does a pit stop right, he'll do them really, really well, but he'll screw them up more often than he should. There's also the fact that he has no real development skills. He's only got 1 point, and that's not going to be enough to level up any category. And he has 1 too few R's in his name. Now that means that while I'll hire him, while I develop the junior mechanic, I'll probably have to let him go in 3 years when the junior mechanic gets experienced enough to take over the senior role, and then we'll hire somebody new. So that's the second disposable person that I'm hiring. Verily, this game brings out your inner bastard. Okay, flipping over to the junior mechanic. The criteria that I've decided on for that, the potential has to be over 30, which means 5 points per skill, 6 times 5, and their total factory skill needs to be over 10, so they have to have at least some base potential in the factory. The choice that I've made there is Rachel McAndrew, and again, this is not as spontaneous a choice as I'm making it sound to you. Rachel's biggest pluses: pit stops and part fix skills are better than average. Actually, Aiden has better part fix skills, but he is really, really bad at pit stops. His concentration is far better, which means that he won't screw up as often, but it'll take him longer to do a pit stop. So overall, we're probably going to be losing out. Second, and most importantly, she has 48 points of potential improvement, so that's 8 points per category. Her biggest minuses, she's 42, so by the time she develops all of her skills, she'll be most likely in her early 50s, and depending on when she peaks, we might need to be looking around for another replacement, but that's 8 to 10 years down the track. She'll never be better than average at concentration, but at least she can become average with that huge number of development points that she has, and she will become a pit stop goddess into the bargain. This is the choice that I have the biggest reservations about, and I would have gone for Ellen McBride had Gary been stronger in part fixes, but I can't really have two weak mechanics in the one area, though I am actually risking that in terms of concentration. So let's go take a look at their profiles. Okay, so we're over in the scouting area. We've got race mechanics selected. This time we're going to sort by name so that I can find them more quickly. So we're looking for Gary Watson to start off with. I forgot to mention Gianni Benvenuti, also an Italian. Lots of potential, ma purtroppo lui è un po' costoso. I would have liked to have had him otherwise. Gary Watson. Okay, Gary, on the other hand, I've worked out, is probably in the range of 30,000 per race. So let's approach him and see what happens. He's unemployed, so he's interested. Let's talk. His wages. I'm not going to offer him anything less than he is going to expect, which I'll give him 33,000. What's the highest I can give him? 49, so almost 50,000. 33. He may reject that. If he does, all the better, because it'll give me a chance to show you how to renegotiate. He's got a lot of patience. Gary's tend to have a lot of patience, usually only the 2R type anyway. You're probably gathering that there is a bit of an in-joke happening here, but we'll just leave that aside for the moment. He wants a long contract, that's fine. I want him for 3 years anyway. He would prefer a signing on fee. I shall give him one. I've budgeted a little bit of money. I've actually budgeted more than that as the signing on fee, if I remember correctly. So, yeah, I'm happy enough to give him that. Bonus size isn't very important. Good, you're not going to get one, because, let's face it, we're not going to be doing well in the first year and a half or so. And I think that will do it for the time being. Okay, so continue. Just be really careful with that, because when you press continue after sending off a contract, you'll be back here and you'll see the same button down there, continue. But if you click it now, it's going to start your calendar running, and you absolutely do not want to do that. You have got a lot to do on your first day, and you need to do it all first. Okay, so let's get back to the scouting area where we were, and we shall, whoops, one too far. We shall go down to the R's to find Rachel. Rachel McAndrew. Now, she only has a chemistry of 6, but even so, in her 18 weeks with her current driver, she's already managed to unlock a level 1 talent. So that means that her chemistry, while low, is still adequate. In the European Racing Series with ZRT, races 10 in 2015, podiums 4. ZRT managed 4 podiums in 2015? That's pretty, and 2 wins. Wow, that's amazing, because they're the second worst team on the grid. Of course, we are the worst. We're number one. Approach mechanic, compare. Okay, she's got all those lovely hollow stars. Oh yeah, I want her. I definitely want her, and I don't mean in the biblical sense. Well, maybe a little bit in the biblical sense. Yeah, if anybody other than you and I ever actually see this film, that is. Aside from which, our team is in such a bad state, there will be no time for romancing anything except new parts suppliers. We shall approach Ms. McAndrew, and she's interested. Let's talk. Okay. I've worked out that her talent should get her about the amount that she's getting paid at the moment, which is about 22,000. But since she's coming from another team, she's not going to transfer from the second worst team in the competition to the worst team in the competition. just because she likes the colour of my eyes, so we're going to have to offer her a little bit more. So let's get up there. That's roughly what she's worth on a fair market value, but we're going to have to offer her a little more to entice her to come and join our team. So I shall go to 25,000. She may reject that. Wages are important to me, so this is going to be probably the prime determiner. She would prefer a medium contract. I would prefer a long contract because I want her to be the cornerstone of our mechanics for probably 5 years at least, maybe even longer than that, subject to the fact that she has really bad concentration. So I'm going to offer her a long contract anyway. Buyout clause, there is no way she will join us if we don't pay that. So you have the choice of team pays all, even split, or person pays all. In other words, Rachel pays all. She will not join us if she has to foot a €105,000 bill, so we will be prepared to pay that. It's worth it in this case. I'd like a nice signing on fee. Okay, so the maximum I can give her is $60,000. I don't want to give her $60,000, so I'm going to offer her initially $30,000. I have a feeling that she'll come back and say, let's talk some more. She has 3 strikes of patience, so we should at least get a response. I think this is a pretty reasonable offer, especially considering that I'm paying her over the odds, and I'm prepared to pay her buyout clause, and I'm going to hit her up with a bonus, signing on fee bonus. Bonus size is quite important to me. Now, the problem there is, okay, this is the way you do this. I will give her a bonus of €60,000 if we come first, which we will not do. Well, actually, no, take that down a bit. 48,000 if we come first, which is not going to happen for at least 2 years, I guarantee it. But the problem with that is, by year three, we may well be coming first on a reasonable number of occasions. But, now I'll leave that in, because I think what's going to happen is that by year three, because we have limited ability in suspension, we're never necessarily going to be first, but if we can always be in the top 3 to top 5, we should still win the championship. So I'm going to send that off to her. Again, be very careful about that continue. Okay, so Rachel's not happy. Let's go back to the negotiating table. I did warn you that this could happen. In fact, I set the conditions so that it might happen, so that I can show you renegotiation. So if they are not rejecting the offer but still want more, you will get an email like this. It'll have a button for contract renegotiation. You can alternatively get to that through the staff menu, so you can see that you've got a one over the staff menu there. So she is unhappy about $25,500. That's unusual. I don't know why she'd be unhappy about this. $4,000 per race, so it's effectively a $40,000 a year pay increase. So, I mean, I'd be happy about that. She's not happy about the signing on fee, even though that's only I'd like. That's okay. I'll up that a little bit. I'll up her salary a little bit, but I'm not going to go overboard with it, because she is technically, for the moment, our junior mechanic, even though she's older than Gary. Well, we haven't got Gary yet, either. Unhappy. Okay. 1 strike against us, so she's still got 2 strikes of patience. Signing on fee, I'm going to, you know what, I'm going to go the whole hog on that, $60,000. It's worth it in this case. That should actually make her delighted, and that would probably be enough to tip the balance. But just to make sure that she doesn't get annoyed with us, I'm just going to up her cost per race to $27,000, which is actually over what her talents are at the moment, but it's probably not over what her talents will be by about halfway through her contract, because she'll be increasing her skills. She's got a pretty decent increased skills rate, and also with the staff centre, she'll be increasing even faster. So I'm going to send that back to her, and we shall see what happens there. Okay, the time machine has now taken us to Tuesday, the 15th of March, 2016. What? This is about last night, isn't it, Rachel? Contract renegotiation. I've given you pretty much everything that you want. Contract renegotiation. What are you not happy about? $27,000 and you're not happy with that. You're delighted with everything else. And now we've got two strikes. Look, honey, you're not actually worth that much. And the only reason I've upped it to that is that you will be worth that much. Actually, let's see how far that is below the minimum. Maximum, rather. That is the maximum. Ah, stuff it. 31, it's only extra 2,000. And like I said, she'll be worth that eventually. So, but my patience is also on strike two, Rachel. So, unless you want to spend the rest of your life at ZRT losing, sign the bloody contract. Oh, thank God. Finally, you've come to your senses. Can we please get back to work? Details. I'm not going to retract the offer. Okay, so finally she's delighted with the cost per race. Actually, I probably could have knocked that back one notch and still gotten her. She's neutral about the contract length because she didn't want to be locked in for that long. At her age, I have no idea why, because you're really looking for longer contracts the older you get. Buyout clause, she's fine with. The signing on fee, she is fine with. Sign her up. Okay, and here I am again speaking to you from the future, and I've slightly screwed up because I actually got a response from Gary 2 days ago, and I just missed it. Gary has responded that the contract is looking good. Let's get that thing signed. Absolutely, Gary! Rachel's still considering. Gary has agreed. I am not going to retract his offer. As I showed you with Freddie, you can see the responses that he had. He's not happy with his cost per race, which... that's about a fair value for Gary. I'm sorry you're unhappy about that, Gary, but that's really what you're worth with only 1 point of development performance. I would have upped that if necessary, but he's delighted with the contract length. He's delighted with the sign-on fee, and those two delighted outweigh the one unhappy. At least he's not insulted the way Freddie was insulted by the signing-on fee, and he's neutral on the race bonus because he's not getting one. Gary, please come and join our team and get to work in my factory because I need you, man. I need you in there now. Which one am I going to replace? It's unfortunate that you can't see what their stats are because I remember one of them had 3 in the factory and the other one had 0 and I can't remember which was which. I think Aya was the one with the 0, so she's the one that I'll replace. It doesn't really matter because they both need to be replaced anyway. And I'm hoping that I'll get a response from Rachel very, very soon. Continue to finances. Okay, so again, I have to pay Gary's sign-on fee, and I get a discount on that because of my financial skills. $29,000, confirm, and Gary is now one of us. Gary Watson! Okay, so we go to mail. We will now see contract signed. From Gary Watson, it's brilliant to have joined you here at Scuderia Quantistica. Looking forward to getting work on improving the car. Getting to work on improving the car. I just wish it was a Renault. No, he didn't actually say that. He just likes French things, Gary does. I know that about Gary. Gary has joined Scuderia Quantistica as their new race mechanic. The 27-year-old will reportedly be working with Andre Gomez. Right, so that takes care of our staff. Now for our drivers. And you might think, well, now we're going to sit through an entire boring spreadsheet presentation on all of our drivers. No, we're not, because I'm not getting rid of these guys. Why? There are 3 reasons, okay? First of all, let's take a look at Andre Gomez, driver details. He actually doesn't have bad stats. The worst stat that he has is that he's got no improvement range, okay? But cornering is okay. Smoothness is actually not bad. Consistency is pretty good. Overtaking is relatively good. Braking is not setting the world on fire. His adaptability and focus, his feedback's good, but feedback's the least of it. But his marketability is actually pretty good. So he's got plus 30 marketability, as opposed to Faith, who has Bupkis. She has the trait of being a nice girl, which improves her mechanic relationship, teammate morale, and the chairman's happiness, but does absolutely nothing for getting me sponsors. So her marketability is 16%. And the effect on that, if we go over to sponsors, our marketability is 35.7%. You may remember when we created the team, we got a boost of 40% from our backers' PR firm. Faith has 16%, Gomez has 51%, and this marketability score is the average of those three. So Faith is actually sucking us down and Gomez is pulling us up. So that's one reason that I'm not going to sack at least Gomez. The main reason I'm not going to sack these two is that look at the cost of break contract. That's going to be 2 million euros. I do not have a spare 2 million euros sitting around. We are going to be essentially scraping for every euro we can get, and I'm not going to waste it in hiring new drivers who could not actually do any better than these two anyway, because our car is such a piece of garbage that you might as well be driving a llama. Alain Prost in his prime could not get that car across the line in a decent position. So there is no point in shelling out 2 million just to get rid of these two, plus the hiring costs and the signing on fees and so on to get two decent drivers for something that's not going to be competitive anyway. So I'm going to stick with these two for the current year. The backup driver is pretty much a waste of space anyway. Nobody cares about the backup driver. Actually, in some strategies at higher levels, the backup driver can be useful. And also, the backup driver can be useful if you know that a driver is going to retire in the foreseeable future and you want to bring some new talent through and maybe promote them into being a main driver. That could be a reason for going out and getting a decent backup driver, but otherwise they're just basically a third wheel. One thing to note here too is that Faith is 34, so she's probably reaching towards the end of her career. The data is, of course, in the... Oh, well, actually, no, it's not for Faith. Faith and Gomez are not actually in the database because I believe that they're built into the program as defaults. If you start a new team, you're probably going to end up with Gomez and Anthony, because I've seen that happen before. It happened on Colonel Failure's channel, who does some Let's Play type videos on this, or has done in the past. And the other thing too is that they have only 10 months remaining on their contract. So essentially at the end of this year, I get rid of them anyway, and I get rid of them at no cost to me. So what I am going to do for the current year is make damn sure that I get over to the scouting department and get Silvia out there and looking for new drivers for me. Now, I would prefer younger drivers, those are race mechanics. No, I want drivers. Okay, I'd prefer younger drivers because I'd rather get somebody with potential and try to bring them through. I want someone cheap. Yeah, I want it all, baby. Okay, so Sylvia is capable of scouting three people at a time because we don't have a scouting headquarters at all. We just have her working out of her office somewhere. I don't know, I've got her down the back office somewhere. So I'm going to get her to start scouting those in order. I know for a fact I'm not going to want Sarah Thomas because although she actually has pretty decent skills, she's a prima donna. Unfortunately, they don't actually have a stat for that in the database, but I have seen Sarah Thomas. She worked with me at Octane on one occasion, and she got on really badly with the mechanic, who was actually a decent mechanic, and she even asked me to fire the mechanic. And then later in a different game where she was not working for me, I saw a news report where she was acting like a prima donna around the pit lane. So unfortunately, that's one that you can't predict ahead of time. The performance of all of these drivers is actually in the database, but because it is hidden, because scouting is part of the strategy that you have to adopt, I turned a blind eye to it. I didn't bring them over into my worksheet. I haven't looked at the numbers. I don't want to know the numbers because that would be basically going into a cheat mode. So the thing is, immediately, from the very first day, start scouting. Okay, have your scout looking for new drivers continuously. Even if you are happy with your current drivers, you are eventually going to need to replace them. They will not be around forever, so you need to be doing that from day one. There are at least two more things that you have to do before you can hit that continue button and start your calendar ticking down. There are actually several things that you probably should do, but two things that you have to do. The first one is to go to the factory. Now, unless you are playing a predefined team and you already have a decent designer, do not start designing new parts. If you have a good designer, then you can start designing new parts, but that's too long a subject for us to cover here. I've covered it partially in one of the previous films. We'll see it once Freddy accepts our offer, if he accepts our offer. You'll already know whether that's the case by now. But just leave it alone, because with your existing designer, let's go to the engine for example, if we have her start to create a new engine, we're going to get something with a score of 6 out of 13 because she has only 4 points of design skill. You are throwing away $1.5 million for nothing, plus component costs. But the thing that you do need to do is start improving parts in your factory. Even though you have lousy mechanics, you still need to get a start on this. Okay, so you've got 4 slots available, 2 in performance, 2 in reliability. The performance is a no-brainer. Just look for the parts that have lowest performance levels. Regardless of which parts you need for the first race, if anything breaks on you, it can cost you the race. So obviously you go for the lowest one and try and build it up. Because we only have 2 pretty bad mechanics and only 16 days until the race, there is no way we are going to get these parts anywhere near 100% reliability. But we will start with the one at 67%. To put something into the reliability queue, you simply click on the spanner symbol, and you see that that goes over there. The next lowest part is 69% by the look of it. Okay, so it doesn't really matter whether you go for the suspension or the brakes. I'm going to go for the suspension. What I will also do is, once we've gotten that up to the low 70s, say, I'll probably swap out at least that part, probably, and replace it with that part so that we can get that brake into the low 70s as well. And also the engine, I'll probably increase that by a few points. So we've got 16 days, we'll leave the existing parts in the reliability team for maybe 7 of those days and then come back and switch over to other parts. Now you will notice down here we've got a completion of time of 12 days after race. That's irrelevant. We're not going to finish anything before the race and it doesn't matter. The point is that at least there will be some improvement in the percentage. So for performance, Black Sea Race, if we remember correctly, has got top speed, acceleration, and high speed corners as the crucial things. The high speed corners is a spec part, so we're looking at top speed and acceleration. So we need to improve the gearbox and the engine. So I'm going to put in the engine for, say, 7 days, and then I'll put the gearbox in for the remainder of the days for the race. So again, I'll just have to manually remember to come back and switch these over sometime around 7 days from the next race. In fact, I may actually put the suspension in for a couple of days too, because that's zero. It's probably not really zero, it's probably a decimal value that's rounding down to zero. But either way, zero is probably lower than it actually should be. So just like scouting, always, always be working on the performance and reliability. Just watch out for one thing. Here it's actually assigned all 10 of the mechanics over to the performance team, which was the last parts that I added. So you need to tweak that back, or you should tweak that back to 5 and 5. In some cases, yes, you will assign all of your mechanics or the majority of your mechanics to one team or another, depending on what your priorities are. But right at this point, our priorities are an equal balance. We need to get up both performance and reliability. The final thing that you need to do before you click on continue is the headquarters buildings, because they take a really, really long time. So you can see here, staff center 14 weeks, scouting facility 12 weeks, forecasting center 16 weeks. If we go to, these are completely new buildings, so they don't have a pre-existing building. The only two we have, as I've mentioned in the past, are the design center and the factory, both of which are level 1. So if you've got an existing building and you're upgrading to a higher level, that's going to be on this button here, the upgrade buildings one. If you're building a completely new building, then that's going to be over here on the new buildings one. So you want to get started as early as possible with one proviso, and that proviso is this. You will probably want to check when the due date is for the building. So in this case, if I start work on the factory right now, and I believe that you need a level 2 factory to be competitive, because you need those 4 slots, you need the 20 mechanics. Yes, it'll cost you 150 grand per race, but it's necessary in my opinion. So obviously I'm going to start work on that pretty much straight away. The one thing that I do check before I start work is the completion date. So you can see 20 weeks from now being the 1st of March, is going to be Tuesday the 19th of July. Looking at the calendar down here, the 19th of July is going to sit pretty well in between the Ardennes race and the Munich race. So that being the case, there's no reason for me not to build it. It means that I'm going to start getting hit with the cost of it as from the Munich race. The other building that I plan to build is a staff centre. I'm a bit of a believer in the staff centre because I'm building up my mechanics from scratch. It actually also helps you develop your drivers, but not my drivers, because as we have seen, they have no development potential. Now, if I start work on that today, it's going to be ready on Tuesday the 7th of June. This is a slightly different situation because that would put it only 2 days before Tondela. Now, the staff centre is of no use to you during the race. It's only useful for preparing your staff for future races. So there is no point getting hit with the cost of it during the Tondela race. You might as well push it back and at least save the money during Tondela, and so it'll become available in the time leading up to the Ardennes race. So if I change that date up to the 4th of March, so I don't start work on it until Friday, then it won't be ready until Friday the 10th of June, which will be 1 day after the Tondela race. So I will not get charged the cost of that for the Tondela race. So how do I build a headquarters building? It is as simple as this. I'm going to upgrade this building. So it's going to be the factory level 2. So you can see it'll give me 10 extra development staff. It'll give me 4 extra slots, 2 in each team. And it will also unlock some of the other buildings, one of which I need in particular, which is the telemetry center, but I won't have the cash to buy it until next season. It's a very expensive building, upgrade 8 million. So all you've got to do is click on that upgrade button. It will then give you some details, such as the cost going from 20 to 170,000 euros per race, tell you the upgrade time, tell you the cost. It will actually be a little bit less for me because I'm a financial wizard, so I'm told. Upgrade, and so I get a discount on that of 400,000, big whoop. Well, actually 400,000 is probably not a bad amount of money. Confirm, and you can see my balance dropping there. Upgrade has started, so that will be ready in 20 weeks, and come Friday I'll start on the staff centre. So, let's head back to the headquarters. One thing that you don't have to do on day one, but I do recommend it anyway, is to take a look at the GMA votes coming up during the year. Work out which ones you want to vote for, which ones you want to conserve votes for, anything that you abstain from. You get to carry that vote into a future round. You don't have to do it on day one, but you should definitely do it before the first vote, which is in 9 weeks. The other thing too, you might want to take a look at your sponsors, if you have any. You would not have a full set of sponsors for each of the slots, so you certainly would not want to be making any decisions when you don't have a full set of sponsors for one slot. Remember that you get 3 offers per slot, and you're probably going to want to see all 3 before you make a decision there. So it's just for curiosity, you don't actually need to take a look at that before you start your calendar, but I would probably take a look at it anyway. And that is about it. So let's recap. Read all of your emails, especially the one from your chairman, about what your expected goal is, so that you can get the money into your bank account, because Lord knows it's not going to stay there for very long. That's if you're a new team. If you're a pre-existing team, you're going to get it after the races, obviously. Get offers out to mechanics if you need to. If you are creating a new team, you will almost certainly need to. Develop a part strategy. It's easier to develop a part strategy if you know how much money you're going to have. To know how much money you're going to have, you're going to have to rough out a budget, even if you do it on the back of an envelope or the metaphorical back of an envelope. The big unknown is going to be your sponsorship money. You can work out your costs pretty easily. You can work out how much you're going to be getting from your chairman. That's easy. But your sponsorship is a big unknown because it depends on the offers that you'll be getting. I would be budgeting for somewhere between 11 and 13 million in your first year. Get offers out to designers if you need to, especially if you're a new team, and base this on your part strategy. So you are looking for designers who are strong in the parts that you want to specialize in. Drivers are more difficult. You don't have any information about any of the drivers to start out with, so start scouting right away. It is better to stay with a couple of bad drivers for a few weeks than to hire somebody sight unseen who you know nothing about and who may turn out to be a complete lemon. Just ask Colonel Failure how that worked for him. Get parts into the factory for reliability and performance upgrades from day one, and keep parts in the factory for reliability and performance upgrades. Towards the end of the year, you'll have a little bit more space. You may not even have enough parts to fill all of the slots, but in the early, at least three quarters of the year, you definitely will. And especially if you're being aggressive in developing new parts, you will constantly have parts needing to go into the factory. Do not build new parts unless you already have a good designer, because you'll be throwing away huge amounts of money for substandard parts. So it's better to wait until you have a good designer. If you do have a good designer, usually if you're a predefined team, then by all means start development of your parts from day one. Choose whatever headquarters buildings you want and either start building on them or plan when you will, such as the staff centre, where I said I'll start building it on the Friday so that I won't get hit with the cost of it in one race. Skim the GMA votes, plan your voting strategy. You don't have to do this on day one, but you might as well get it out of the way. Look at your sponsorship offers if you have any, but you will not have all three offers for even one of the slots. So, if possible, do not accept any offers for any of the slots until you have all three offers. At that point, you can take a deep breath and hit the continue button. And that is exactly what we will be doing next weekend in a video which I promise you will be shorter than this one. This one is going to be the high water mark, but I wanted to get all of that content in. But that's your bite for this weekend. So until next time, have a great weekend and goodbye.